Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song,
my soul, praising my Savior. Yeah. of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll
is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll
is called up yonder.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll
is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
If we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We begin our service of thanksgiving and celebration as we offer the rite of the reception of the body. With faith and Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a compassion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Kindly be seated. The tribute will be offered by Dr. Sonia Peter.
Good morning, all. The family is extending sincere appreciation to all of you who took the time to be with us here today, or the opportunity to stream this service of thanksgiving for my brother. I do believe that we can see the picture of him facing audience, but we know those who are here grieving with us today, and even those who are streaming. That picture really speaks a volume about my brother, especially the shot in the corner. He was always smiling and willing to engage, and I know many of you know him for that purpose. Andrew Everton de Vere Burrowes was born on December 5th, 1952. Our mum, Merle, described him as a mass of curls, long legs, and puffy cheeks, as any mother would. He was named after his dad, Everton, and grew up an inquisitive child who never shied away from adventure and was known to the neighborhood of Powder Road Station Hill, St. Michael, where he grew up, for his many escapades. He embraced the traditions of his childhood and shared many with me when I could tag along on the heels of my big brother. This is how he learned. Yes, I'm sorry, I was reading ahead. As Barbadians would say, Andrew liked to pull down and put back together. This is how he learned, and by my memory, could find ways to fix any household item in need of attention. Sometimes he fixed them the technician way, sometimes his way, finding alternative materials and methods to complete the task. When he was a young teenager and student at the modern high school, I remember him building mobile wooden toys, assembling them from spare parts he sourced, including wheels and gears, steering and the lot. This was much to my delight, as it fueled my imagination. I must confess that I never acquired his building skills, but he did show me how to construct a pretty good kite, even if only to fly from our front window. Under his guidance, I became good at fishing in rain pools that had no fish, snaring unfortunate lizards with the right plant stem, daring to handle a bicycle in traffic at only 7 years old, knowing the right way to break an egg without fully cracking the shell to consume the rich contents, shaking a leg to calypso music, and never thinking about failure, just the pleasure of adventure. Andrew took this spirit into the world of martial arts when he joined the then Avalon Karate Club to maintain his physical fitness and, as he would say, to keep a dapper appearance. He climbed this new experience with ease, becoming a black belt in quick time, rising to the level of third dan and assuming the role of chief instructor for many years. He was very proud of this achievement and never hesitated to demonstrate his prowess, including sneak attacks on our mother's new drapery. After stints in the accounts department of Collins Limited and Hilton Hotel in the 1970s, he decided to pursue his passion for technical work. He became a technician in air conditioning and refrigeration, venturing into the world of self-employment. During this time, he also became a dad to two beautiful daughters, Lynn Marie and Lisa Marie. The girls immigrated to the US, eventually carrying their dad's and mom's adventurous spirits, and he proudly displayed all pictures and letters he received. Many of these can be seen in the memorial booklet. He has a lovely granddaughter, Caitlin, and often spoke about how she reminded him of our mother as a young girl. Andrew was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease soon after the passing of our mother. Looking back, there were small signs of the ensuing confusion. Andrew had a sense of style, and one day I visited his apartment to find him in layered clothing on a very hot day with a belt fashioned from unusual materials. When questioned, he was amazed and shocked, really, that I was so out of touch with the latest fashion craze. Unfortunately, he declined from there, requiring residential care and professional management eventually. I believe that his physical training served him well, and the sense of dignity instilled by our mother saw his manners preserved throughout. His physician, Dr. Ramsey, experienced his strength on one, his strength on one of his checkup visits, when he requested that Andrew squeeze his hand as firmly as he could. Andrew complied with great manners, "Of course, sir," but forgot to release the grip as the doctor urged him with, "You can let go now, Mr. Burrowes." The staff of Faith and Love Residential Citizens Care kept Andrew well-groomed and at comfort in his new environment. Though the accumulation of plaque in the brain associated with the disease clouded his sense of the world around him, there was always a sense of peace that I found in his inner perception. His manner was still engaging, and I think he even got a hint of a proposal from a family member of another resident. Losing a loved one is difficult, and though we speak of filling our hearts with memories, it is a big task for these memories to push back the pain. However, today I choose to be thankful for his life lived. Thankful that he reached the pinnacle of his journey into martial arts. Thankful that he was and is embraced by the love of his daughters. Thankful that he was able to keep his grandmother, Ivy Burrowes, and his uncle, Anthony Burrowes, close to his heart in his last memories of family. Thankful that he got to know his nieces and nephew for the short period he lived with us in the early stages of the disease, and for the many shared hours with our late son, who would visit him every day when he first went into residential care. Thankful that he got to know his grandnephews, Mackay Belgrave and Luke Edie, whom we call the professor, now 8 years old, who would often tell him back then, "You must eat all of your food to keep strong." Thankful for the many friends he made, including the Reed family of Mansion Road, Sylvester Ford, Godfrey Dakota, Peter Warren, and the other members of the Avalon Karatek Club who are either here with us today or watching the live stream. Thankful for the many family members or cousins who have touched his life, including the Burrowes, Thorpe, Batson and Hines families. I end this tribute to my brother. As we take him into peaceful rest with a poem by Ellen Brenneman. Don't think of him as gone away. His journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets, this earth is only one. Just think of him as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think how he must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in the hearts of those he touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much. May he rest in peace.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia Peter, for that very eloquent tribute. We stand now to sing the hymn, Lead Us, Heavenly Father, Lead Us. Without end, and whose mercies cannot be numbered, make us, we pray, deeply aware of the shortness and uncertainty of human life, and let your Holy Spirit lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days, that when we shall have served you in our generation, we may be gathered to our ancestors, having testimony of a good conscience, in the communion of the Catholic Church, in the confidence of a certain faith, in the comfort of a religious and holy hope, in favor with you, our God, and in perfect charity with the world. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Kindly be seated for the first Bible reading.
Good morning to all. The first reading is taken from Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 to 11. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which was planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What profit hath he worketh and that wherein he laboreth. I have seen the trivial which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in its time. Also he hath set the world in their heart, so that no man can find out the work of God, the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. And here ends the first reading.
We now have the second Bible reading, which has been changed from Deuteronomy to Thessalonians chapter 4. And it will be read by Lisa Marie Burrowes.
Good afternoon, everyone. And the scripture says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we
For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from the heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." Here ends his reading.
Thank you.
We stand to sing the hymn, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine." I speak to you in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Kindly be seated. I believe in the communion of saints. I believe in the communion of saints. So often in life, we recite or repeat things and do not quite understand or stop or pause to think about what we are saying. I believe in the communion of saints. So what do we really think or understand when we recite that line in the Apostles' Creed? Perhaps if I were to ask you for the definition of a saint, your first response would be to conjure up in your minds a pale, ethereal, a sallow looking figure with a light over their heads, a halo such as seen in religious spaces and places, such as perhaps we learned in Sunday school, we saw in Sunday school or on the Bible. So let us pause for a moment and see if we can examine this for a short while. The word saint comes to us from the Latin word sanctus. And sanctus and saints mean dedicated to God. Dedicated to God. So that which is dedicated to God. We speak of the Bible, which is the word of God. But we refer to it as the Holy Bible, which means it is a book dedicated to the Word of God. We go to church and we see the altar, which symbolizes the table around which Jesus had his final meal with his friends. And we refer to that as the Holy Table. A table, an item of furniture, if you wish, dedicated to the work and the service of God. So then, we can take a short step and say to ourselves that a saint is that person who has been dedicated or set aside for the work of God. A saint or saints are those people who have been dedicated or set aside for the work of God. In the New Testament, it seems that every baptized member of the church was referred to as a saint. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 7, we read, "To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints." Those who are from the Bible, who we refer to now as saints, were very ordinary people like us. There was nothing special about them. Think about them. James and John were fishermen. And you and I know that fishermen were and are a very colorful character with a very colorful vocabulary. Matthew was a tax collector, one of those people, one of those occupations that are not very well looked upon because it seems as though they always want to take money from us and more money than we are prepared to give them. And then, of course, there was Martin, after whom we have a church named in St. Philip. Martin was a soldier. And no doubt before he was baptized, before he set himself apart, before he became dedicated as a soldier, he would more than likely have killed quite a few people. I believe in the communion of saints, not the airy-fairy, milk and water-looking creatures we sometimes see on our church walls and in religious works, but real people living real lives, facing the daily challenges of life, sometimes meeting them, and sometimes not, but going on and persevering in the best way we know how, in the faith of the God we know and believe in. Was our brother Andrew a saint? By the standards of some people, maybe not. But then again, as the Bible says, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if so, then we dare not stand in judgment, lest we too come up wanting in the eyes of God. As we go through life, we recognize that we all have demons, real and imaginary. Demons with whom we fight. Demons with whom we fight private wars and battles, which we sometimes share with others and sometimes prefer to keep to ourselves. And as my grandmother was fond of saying, man sees the action, but God sees the heart. You would have heard the eulogists mention in glowing terms about Andrew's ability to take apart and put back together. You would have heard her mention about his commitment and his passion for martial arts. And obviously, he was a man who lived a good life. He was a person who lived a life to the best that he could. He was, I would like to hope, believe, and think, will remain in our memories for many, many a long time. I believe in the communion of saints. Those of our friends and family we have known and loved and been a part of our lives for better or for worse and are still with us even after they have given up the bodies by which we have known them. Remember what I said. They are still with us even after they have given up the bodies by which we have known them. For the writers to the Hebrews in chapter 12 speaks of a cloud of witnesses who are encouraging us in this earthly race. And the hymn writer gives us comfort and consoles us with these well-loved words. There is a land of pure delight where saints immortal reign, where infinite day excludes the night and pleasures banish pain. Our brother is no longer confined to a body ravaged by time and illness. Our brother is no longer fighting his demons, uncertain and perhaps fearing for the future. Our brother has made his transition from life in the body to life in the spirit. He is indeed now among the saints of God. But as Christian people, we never say goodbye. Rather, we say farewell, Andrew. Vaya con Dios. Go with God until we meet again. Amen and amen. Let us stand now as we sing the hymn, "To God be the glory, great things he hath done." the prayers and commendation. At the end of each written prayer, your response is, "Hear our prayer." Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life, which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy. May we be strengthened in our faith, live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy. Show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. We commend all people to your unfading love, that in them your will may be fulfilled, and we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother Andrew, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and when you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. Amen. Our brother Andrew will be taken from the chapel for cremation, and invite you now to join with me in the prayers of committal. I heard a voice from heaven saying, "Write this: Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Andrew, and we commit his body to the elements, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor. But when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Andrew and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn, "When Peace Like a River."
love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever.
Amen.
God bless you.
We walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will over.